So today I'll be talking about basically my PhD work, which finished late last year, and it was about radio transients, as some surveys that I did, sort of preliminary surveys, and some techniques that I developed during the time I was doing a PhD. So this was, again, with help from Tara, Brian and Tim, who are my supervisors, as well as a lot of help from Dick Hunstead and Shami Chatterjee early on, who's now at Cornell. Today I'll talk to you a little bit about setting the scene of why we're talking about transients. A lot of you are transients people, I noticed, so you probably won't need to hear a lot about that. And then I'm going to talk about two pilot surveys, an archival search for radio transients and variables with the Molonglo Observatory Synthesis Telescope. I'll talk a little bit about dispersion before I lead into a few other things in the high time resolution domain. So another was a pilot survey doing robotic follow-up of gamma ray bursts. And I'll talk about a few techniques related to dispersion or de-dispersion. So just to motivate us a bit, why are we talking about radio transients? This is for the people who aren't really necessarily in that field. Basically, the transient radio skies is quite poorly explored at radio wavelengths compared with other wavelengths. So there's plenty of wide-field optical and gamma ray and X-ray experiments, but radio, it's kind of hard to do that, or hasn't been done very well in the past. So, and things that we do know that change quite dramatically in the radio once you actually know they're there are, you know, explosions or propagation effects, accretion effects, magnetospheres of certain type of compact objects, and perhaps the most interesting thing that we hope to find is what we don't really know already, or the unknown. Another reason this is interesting is because we're really on the cusp of a new era in wide-field radio astronomy. Whereas in the past we've sort of used serendipity or just a bit of good luck and some maybe monitoring some known sources and follow-up from other wavelengths, and we've really had very limited sort of wide-field blind survey capabilities. You know, what we're coming into now is just looking, monitoring everything all the time. So. But nonetheless, these previous methods have been actually quite useful. And just to highlight a few successes, I guess. Serendipity was kind of a good luck was associated with detecting the first pulsar, finding scruff on a page. This is the sort of scruff on a page that turned out to be a pulsating signal. If you're monitoring something that looks really boring for a long time and then suddenly it does something really crazy, this is an extreme scattering event. So if you're doing really boring monitoring and something exciting happens, you're really happy that you did that boring monitoring. But this is why you want to be able to monitor everything the whole time. You want to measure the flux density of the entire sky every day. And from that, you can actually measure some really, you can maybe discover some really exciting things. And then this is another example of follow-up from other wavelengths. So this was a supernova that was detected in optical. And then radio follow-up over a few months shows that the spectrum here, this is the radio spectrum in gigahertz here and flux density here, the radio spectrum, the peak drifts down over time, so from 10 gigahertz here down to about a gigahertz here, and also the flux density reduces a bit. And from that you can determine that this is actually a relativistic supernova. And what people are looking for is an orphan gamma ray burst afterglow. So this was a gamma ray burst where you didn't see gamma rays, but we saw the radio afterglow that looked a lot like a gamma ray burst. These approaches have been really good, but really what you want to do is, instead of following things up or monitoring just, you know, individual sources, you want to probe this parameter space. For instance, here we're looking at flux density versus snapshot rate, so how much of the sky you see versus how deep you look. And really you want to be pushing in this direction down here, okay? You want to find, you know, go to really, you know, faint sources, and you want to see, this is the opposite of sky coverage, so you want to, you know, be able to look for really rare things. So this is rare and faint in that direction. So you want to probe that part of the parameter space as much as you can. And to do that, you need wide field instruments that are really sensitive. If you also want to start a new branch of astronomy, you need a few other things. So just by example, in the case of pulsars, you know, you build a new telescope in 1963. This is the confluence of a bunch of things. Confluence of, you know, a new telescope in 1963, the CDT 3200 computer in 1965, the fast Fourier transform was rediscovered, I guess, in 1965, and then the pulsar was discovered in 1968, not by the Recibo, but nonetheless. Once you have these things together, suddenly you get a whole new branch of astronomy, which is pulsar astronomy, very close to people at CAASS, as you may know. So now again, you know, hopefully we're in the same position. You know, we've got a new telescope here with this ASCAP and MWA. New computing in terms of the sorts of commodity hardware, the capabilities of the commodity hardware are really massively increasing. New algorithms, I hope to contribute in my own small way, not the FFT, quite as exciting as that, but something like it. And we have the whole universe now, because we can observe the whole universe, we can observe the whole sky every day, or we're hoping to do that. So again, I hope, hopefully, that to convince you that this you know, wide field era will really, you know, be the beginning of a new flourishing part of astronomy. So to talk about this work then, what I'm going to talk about is some pilot surveys and algorithms, and try and hopefully run these two things hand in hand. The reason you want to do pilot surveys is to inform, you know, upcoming surveys with transient rates and what you expect to see, so that you can optimize your survey to find the most number of things. You want to be able to design algorithms that will find, you know, the needles in the haystack. You want to look at some real-world data problems, so you can have some understanding of what you're going to run into in terms of trouble, so that you can deal with it quickly and move on. And you can, you know, make some early scientific gains. And so today I'm going to talk about these two pilot surveys here, the Molonglo survey and the 12-meter follow-up. And then in the algorithms domain, you want to actually robustly compute some metrics that mean something, that, you know, tell you something, that extract really information out of this vast volume of data we're going to see. We want to be able to, you know, deal with real-world data problems that that come up in data that don't often come up in the kind of theoretical treatments that you might like to understand. Hopefully with, you know, some better algorithms, we can improve the sensitivity or open up new parameter spaces that might not otherwise be available to us because of other computational reasons. And again, in the same vein, you know, improve the computational efficiency that make, you know, some problems, previously intractable problems, actually tractable. So getting onto the first survey that I did, the 22-year Southern Sky Survey for Transient Variable Rate. It's a real mouthful, I'm sure you can read it. So there's a bit here about surveys, and there's also a bit about algorithms, which I'll talk to you about. A little bit about the survey. This is a typical image from the Molonglo telescope. It's an east-west array. I'll show you a picture in a minute. And the reason we were trying to do this is just, you know, to characterize the sky in this new part of the parameter space. This telescope has covered the whole sky, the whole southern sky once, south of minus 30. And we were looking at, you know, new objects and to do all the sorts of science that I've just briefly just talked about before. So the telescope here, it's a 1 mile long cylindrical paraboloid. It's in here in just next to Canberra. There's actually part, the north-south part is no longer used, so it's just the east-west part that actually makes the interferometer. And in the archive of this instrument, there's about 7,000 images. It has actually quite a wide field of view, up to about 2 degrees north-south. A reasonably good sensitivity of about 5 sigma of 14 millijansky. It operates at 843 megahertz. So just if you look at the archive, this is a Lambert projection. So the south pole here is in the middle. This area around here is minus 30 declination. So you can see it's covered the whole sky once, and that was the what's called the SUMS survey, which was the southern equivalent of NVSS, which is an all-sky survey done by the VLA. So this covered the sort of bottom, you know, the last quarter of the sky. You can see here that the galactic plane's been looked at quite a lot. That's the galactic plane there. Galactic plane. And there's a few other places that have been hit here quite a lot. The Hubble Deep Field, for instance. So this is the archive coverage of all the images, and this is the archive coverage that I actually used. And I'll tell you why I threw out quite so many images later. Basically, this was part of a quality control cut. I'm a big believer in if you want to find out what's wrong with your telescope, then you look for variability, because that generally artifacts will come up and change the flux density of things, and so they'll look like they're variable. So we did a lot of work trying to really clean up this data set so we could actually make it usable. This is one example of a little algorithm that we cooked up to help out with that quality control. What he plotted here is the measured flux density versus the catalog flux density of a bunch of sources that were in a field. And what you see here is if you just fit, so what we're looking for here is how well can we measure our sources with respect to how we've measured them one time in the past against some, you know, canonical flux density. So if you just plot this one measured versus catalogued, you can see you get roughly a straight line, and the gradient of that line tells you if there's some gain, you know, constant gain offset of, or gain, sorry, associated with your image. This was one example where we had a gain of, you know, 0.9, so everything was down by 0.9, you know, down by 10% with respect to the catalogue, which is quite a lot. And so if you've got then the catalogue image, which is the first image that was taken, and then this image, that everything's varied by 10%, and you go, well, that's quite interesting. As it turns out, that's not actually true, because it's all the sources, it's unlikely that every source in that part of the sky would go down simultaneously by 10%, so this sort of algorithm picks it up. But what's interesting about that is you can see we've discarded one point here that was more than, I don't know, 3 sigma from the fit. What you can see then is this is a perfectly, you know, nice looking image. I can show it to you if you like. It looks fine, but you can see there's a lot of scatter around this line, and that tells you that you're not reliably able to actually measure the flux density in this image of a number of sources. And so, you know, that helps you flag things out and say, look, we're just not going to bother with this image. So that's one useful little trick that we use to clean things up. Another little statistics trick that we used, I wasn't quite sure that we were actually measuring our errors very well. So one of the ways we checked this was just to look at, for each source we'd have a light curve, and then we'd measure the chi-squared of the fit of just line of constant flux density. So you assume every source is constant and measure the chi-squared of that. And then take the histogram of chi-squareds of all the different sources. Or in fact, you have to measure the, because the chi-squareds are all different, you just use the probability distribution. Because the number of degrees of freedom is different, you throw in the probability distribution and you get back a probability. Ideally, everything should be equally likely, right? But what this is saying is that there's an excess of very, very flat looking sources and a dearth of really rarely, you know, very highly variable sources. And you can see this is nice sort of trend. And this is telling you that we've really slightly overestimated our error bars, right, with respect to the scatter that we see. So there's more, you know, there's basically less scatter than we'd expect given our error bars. So that was a useful thing to know, at least we're being conservative. But what's also nice to know is that right up here, there's this massive excess of variable sources. And this is what we really know, okay, we're actually detecting really variability here. It's not just scatter. And it's not to do with error bars. It's really, really quite, you know, significant. So the end result was we detected 15 what we call transients. So transient in this case is just not detected at least once. Three of them were known, these famous sources. One was sitting on an optical galaxy, which I'll show you. The remainder are just on blank optical field. This is very common in Molonglo data. A lot of these things are radio galaxies or quasars that just don't have optical counterparts down to, you know, what the survey sensitivities are. A few were detected in NVSS. And we find 53 very highly variable sources, and I'll show you a few of those, and about 400 variable sources. So here's the transient that we detected that was previously unknown. You can see it's not detected in this sort of years. That's the NVSS non-detection, and then up here it's suddenly 20 millijansky. This is the initial, the Molonglo data. You can see it's a little bit offset with respect to the beam, so it's kind of telling you maybe something happened. There's a 12-hour synthesis with Molonglo, so this might tell you that there's something changing over the synthesis time. It's a very high, this redshift 0.02, I think, 0.03, 0.04, and quite a high luminosity if it was considered to be a radio supernova or something like that. So, but some compact array follow-up here. It's hard to see the very middle of it, but that's the red is the long low contours, and the green is the compact array 5 gigahertz. And you can see it's I don't know anyone who can do optical galaxy fitting, but I'm pretty sure this is still offset from that from the center of that source. So I'm going to look into that as well. But that's a very, I mean, if it was an AGN, it would be sitting dead set in the middle and varying a little bit. But that's a lot of variability for an AGN, and it's also, if it is offset, then that's a lot of variability for something that's offset from a galaxy. So this is still ongoing. I don't really know quite what this is yet. It needs a little bit more work with the compact array data. But yeah, so that's kind of an interesting result so far. The SWIFT had some X-ray follow-up, and there's nothing really there. I have that for my own memory, really. This is another variable source. So you can see the red here is the Molonglo data, and there's some actual some detections also in some compact array archival data. And you can see it sits well truly offset from that source. And once again, in compact array follow-up last year, it's still offset and it's still there. So about a millijansky again for that one. Nothing in the X-ray. This is another one I'm finding quite interesting. You can see it. That's the MVSS data, and then it doubles in flux density over about 6 years, which is just odd, especially seeing as it sits on this very nice star-forming galaxy. Again, you don't really expect to see luminous AGN, radio-loud AGN at the center of star-forming galaxies, and you certainly don't just expect them to see them varying by that much. So again, that's a little bit of a puzzle, and looking into that a bit more. That's the light curve again, but in luminosity units, and the compact array data seems to show a little bit of sort of partly resolved structure in there. So it looks like there's some, like a core starburst happening in there that's kind of bubbling away, and something has gone off in the middle of that, and that's what's responsible for the change in the flux density. So the good thing about these is they're little puzzles that need a bit of work, and we don't really know exactly what they are, and so that's why we're trying to follow them up as much as we can. The end result of it, of course, is that the sky is variable, which is nice. I mean, everyone knew this. maybe we can uncover new types of event, or slightly things that are outside of what we know a really secure kind of understanding. One of these things I think might be a dot tidal disruption flare, but that's just because they're fashionable at the moment. And we've got some compact array and optical follow-up. But the majority of what we see are probably scintillating AGN that kind of tallies with what we know so far. And some new techniques that have come out of that might be useful for some other people too. So they're getting implemented on VAST, for instance, the ASCAP array, the ASCAP survey that's doing much the same as what I've shown here. Just a quick side point to talk about dispersion, because it relates to my next two sections. If you haven't come across it before, dispersion is an effect that happens in the interstellar medium. So if you have a short duration radio pulse that gets emitted by some source like a pulsar, as it travels towards us, the interstellar medium effectively delays the lower frequencies with respect to the high ones. So here's a plot here of just time versus frequency for the Wiebke pulsar, and you can see you get this very characteristic sweep. This is one on a frequency squared frequency sweep. So for zero dispersion, you would just get a vertical line in this plot, and the more dispersion you have, the more angle, the lower the gradient is in that kind of direction. So that's just a key point that's going to come up. When you're doing dedispersion, you have to remember that the higher frequencies arrive before the lower frequencies. The dispersion measure measures how angled this is with respect to the amount of with respect to the vertical. And often you don't know if you're looking for something new, you don't know the dispersion measure in advance, so you have to search for it. So let's say this is your curve that I showed you before, then you have to try all these different dispersion measures and eventually add up on all the right ones, and then you're happy. So that's just the dispersion. So you have dispersion, which happens in the interstellar medium. The dispersion, if you want to find something that's already been propagating through that, and then you're happy. So that's just a little interlude, and we'll go on and talk about another survey. This was an automated high time resolution follow-up of a gamma ray bursts at 1.4 gigahertz. So does what it says on the tin. Again, it's a pilot survey. So why on earth do you want to do this? Well, a couple of reasons. A few years ago, there was a very exciting publication in Science where some guys had looked through some archival data with parks and found this single pulse. This is the dispersion curve here. And it was massively exciting because it was incredibly bright, and it looked like it was extragalactic, and if these things are happening, then you can find out all sorts of interesting stuff. So there was a lot of excitement associated with this Lorimer burst, and in the paper they said, well, it could have been a gamma ray burst. A gamma ray burst is an exploding star, and we see gamma rays we think it's an exploding star, and we see gamma rays coming from the explosion. They hit a satellite, which tell you things about the burst itself. So the reason is, this was an exciting event, so maybe we can see if we can find more of them. That's one reason. No one has actually done this sort of experiment before at high time resolution. That's another reason. And if you find something, you know, there's a good goodies in there for you. So if you do find actually that you can get these things regularly from astronomical sources, then you can measure all sorts of things about the explosion itself, so the physics of the physics of the gamma ray burst. You can also measure, it tells you a lot about the intervening material, so how many baryons there were between you and it, tells you about the turbulence between you and the thing and the explosion and so on. So there's more than that, you can do you can distinguish between cosmic reionization models if you detect one of these things at redshift 10, which people claim to have done. But radio pulses, not so much. So maybe if you find it, let's go find these things and see what happens. Okay, so a little bit about how gamma ray bursts are detected. There's a satellite out there called SWIFT. It was launched by NASA. It orbits the Earth. It sees most of the sky most of the day. And it detects gamma ray bursts. Within a few seconds of the gamma ray burst actually being detected, it has a position for it. That position gets sent over the internet by NASA. And then you hook your telescope up to NASA, and it goes and observes this source within a few minutes of the gamma ray burst actually happening. So that's the way this experiment worked. Also hooked it up to my Google Mail so I could find out what the telescope was doing without having to watch it all the time. And it was on source within about 2 minutes of the gamma ray burst. So what we're looking for is the single pulses. We're also looking for a pulsar type emission, as in something that's regularly spinning around. And we also look for long time scale variation, but that pretty much was useless because of this. Oops. Right. What I used for this experiment was the 12 meter telescope at Parkes. This is a test telescope for the ASCAP array that CAS is building out in Western Australia, well, here. I needed to get a feed on it, and so that we rustled around in, I don't know if it was in John Reynolds' office, but anyway, somewhere around there, and found this thing called the bucket feed, so called because it's made out of a bucket. So that's it being installed on the 12 meter. 12 meter usually has a focal plane array on it that people are testing, but it didn't at that time. So I stayed out of the engineers' way. The end result was we detected a few things that were rather intriguing. So this is a plot here of time on this axis. This is half an hour, basically a half an hour after the gamma ray burst went off. This is the DM, so how angled that pulse was with respect to the vertical, for how much, which describes how much intervening material there is. And what you can see is about, I don't know, 7 or 8 minutes after the gamma ray burst goes off, there's a few six sigma events that are all clustered together in DM in this DM space here. So the reason they've got crosses around them was because they're detected by a friend-of-friend algorithm as being all in a cluster. The red ones are just six sigma peaks that are sitting by themselves. So this is quite interesting, right? This is exactly the way you'd expect a six sigma pulse from a gamma ray burst to look, which is very exciting. Unfortunately, six sigma is not a lot in this game. As you can see here, there's this green stuff, this gray stuff, sorry, which is classified as RFI. RFI often lives quite low in this plot, sort of around the zero area, and that's why things that go through zero tend to be classified as RFI. So the RFI is really a killer in this game. If you have a little pulse of RFI, and if it's sort of not broad band but not narrow band but somewhere in the middle, that's also what you'd expect to see exactly like that. Nonetheless, if you zoom in on this thing and look at it, for instance, I have two polarizations, so these are the two polarizations. This is dispersed now, so I've got, so in this plot, dispersed emission is vertical, so you can see it here, it lives in the X and Y polarizations, it's quite significant there, and in the sum it also looks quite good. This looks like it's, either circularly polarized or unpolarized. Quite significant. Another piece of this puzzle, again, it's a bit of a puzzle, is if you look at this is the X-ray light curve, okay? The X-ray light curve is measured by this satellite SWIFT in response to the GRB alert that it sends out. This X-ray light curve is measured in a number of different ways, which is the different colors. But the point is here is that people often fit breaks in this broken power law to this thing. And the time of arrival of this pulse happens to coincide within one sigma of the break in the power law, which is again kind of an interesting clue. Is it significant? I don't really know. It may turn out to be if you couldn't get enough of these things. But it's an interesting kind of point. again, if this, we actually detected two pulses after gamma ray bursts, and this is the second one. And you can again see this is a bit less significant. It's 1.5 sigma away from the break in the power law. But once again, it kind of looks suspicious. What it's worth noting, though, I should say, is that we actually observed between here and here. So on the log scale, it actually looks like it's more significant than it is. You've got a 20% chance of randomly falling within the error bars of the break here. So, you know, how significant is that? I mean, it's not a killer thing. So the real question about that stuff, I mean, it's an interesting upper limit. If nothing else, it's, you say 7 sigma is my upper limit, and no one's measured upper limits, so there's time resolution before, so in that sense, it's a nice upper limit paper. But the question is, well, is it real? So there's an argument in both directions of whether it's real. If you just do Gaussian statistics and say how many trials do I have, and how many, you know, I've got 6.6 sigma event, what does that mean? I can say, well, it's unlikely at about 3 sigma. You know, 99.8% confidence. Sadly, I didn't actually get a pointing on a blank piece of sky, which would have been handy, because that would have let you characterize the background rate. I didn't actually think I'd detect anything, so I didn't think it would be that important. But so with hindsight, it would have been great. So instead, we just took the time frequency plot that I showed you earlier and shuffled all the channels. And by shuffling the channels, that gets rid of the pulse that you're in, but it keeps the kind of general statistics of what's going on. So if you shuffle all the channels and then you run it through your pipeline again, that's like looking at a piece of blank sky, kind of. So you do that a few times and you can rule out, and so out of, I don't know, 200 trials, I detected two pulses that were in the data. And so I can say, well, 99% of the time, if you do that shuffling, you don't see anything. So that's kind of a nice thing in the sort of pro column. In terms of the physics of known sources, you know, the rate is totally incompatible with what, you know, the rate of gamma ray bursts, the rate of other background sources foreground sources that might have been in the field at the time. And like I said, there's a 20% chance of a random event falling on an X-ray break, a break in the X-ray light curve. So that's kind of good on the pro camp. On the other side of the it's fake and don't worry about it, is a population argument. So you might just look at this and say gamma ray bursts basically you see everywhere between redshift very close and redshift 6. So what are the chances, given that spatial distribution, that you happen to detect two that are right near your detection threshold? And the answer is 2%. So on that, you know, on that likelihood, it's like basically saying, let's say I take two random stars, and what are the chances that they both happen to have exactly the same magnitude? You know, that's not very high. So there's all sorts of other things, you know, equipment RFI or equipment failure or some unlucky piece of RFI. So the end result of this is you need to go and do some more follow-up with a better telescope, and we should basically be able to rule these things out or not. Or take something new. So the end result, the conclusions from that is you can still do good things with a small telescope. You know, we were on source within 2 minutes, which is quite fast in the radio realm. People are often, you know, on source within a few hours or even days for gamma ray bursts. So that was 2 minutes was a bit of an achievement. We'll try and confirm it with another telescope, hopefully soon. But you know, the source of these pulses, you know, who knows? Something to do with a gamma ray burst. My guess was the formation of a black hole at the center of the GRB. So often a gamma ray burst is posited to have a magnetar at the center. So the star collapses. In the middle, there's a magnetar that's rapidly rotating, but with a higher mass than the Chandrasekhar mass, so that it should be a black hole. But because it's rotating, it avoids its doom until it sheds enough energy, at which point, a few hundred seconds after the GRB, then it can contract and form an event horizon. So maybe something to do with that. Last section I'm going to talk about today is two new techniques for antenna coherent detection of dispersed radio pulses, and I call them the Chirpolator and the Chimageator, just because otherwise they'd just be the things in Bannister et al. So the Chirpolator and the Chimageator. The motivation for doing these things is, like I said before, it's kind of exciting if you can find these fast transients, and the better sensitivity you can get and the better field of view you can get, the more likely you're able to find something. And you know, you can find all sorts of things if you have better sensitivity. You can find pulsars and rotating radio transients. there's this Lorimer burst, you can do maybe SETI, maybe aliens are blowing each other up in nuclear bombs, and you can see those. You know, but we don't really have a lot of these, you know, events, so if you can find more of them, that's good. So that's the scientific motivation. So this is just a little taxonomy of approaches that you can take in order to find these sorts of things. You can have a single dish, and then when you do this dedispersion, you can do it in a non-coherent way, so you can add up channels, or you can do it in a coherent way, which is you can digitally filter the baseband data stream and basically invert the interstellar medium. So there are sort of two ways you can do it in single dish mode. With an interferometer, you've got this question of how do you combine your antennas together, right? And you can do a similar sort of playoff. You can say, well, if you can incoherently add your antennas together, so you take total power measurements from two antennas, you add them together, and then you can do a frequency incoherent dedispersion, okay? That's one trace down here. Or if you have an antenna coherent version, then you get better sensitivity in this case, and you can do a few other tricks. You can play, you can do an image of the sky in the same way that interferometers always do. Or you can form timed array beams, which are basically what people use for VLBI, which is you add all your antennas together. Right, this one you're multiplying antennas together. This one you're adding antennas together to get a single beam on the sky. And in these cases, you can do frequency coherent in this case, but only non-coherent in this case. They're the kind of standard classical ways of doing things. Now this one, so if you want to then go and design a survey, here you're really limited by the size of your dish, and you just can't build many bigger dishes than Arecibo, right? And the other trade-off here is that, you know, the bigger your dish is, the smaller your field of view, unless you add little multi-beam things, but you're kind of limited there. The antenna incoherent method here is, you know, has poor sensitivity. These things and these other things are very expensive or have a very small field of view, so there's not really much attraction in doing this sort of stuff. Unless you realise that, well, the future is really interferometers. At the moment, the SKA is, you know, an array. So you really want to be able to exploit arrays as best you can. So the point here is, you know, we're not really going to build any bigger telescopes than Arecibo. SKA is going to be an array. You want to have some nice long baselines so you can find, if something arrives, you can find out where it was and follow it up with some other telescopes. And how do you take advantage of all these dishes without sacrificing your field of view in terms of sensitivity and field of view? So to this end, I kind of add a couple of other new ideas here, like the Chirpolator and the Chimageator, and they live here in this antenna coherent approach. The key point here with the Chirpolator is you can imagine it like you're dedispersing yourself, okay? It's kind of weird, but I'll try to explain it a little bit slowly. So this is time here in this axis and frequency in this axis. And just assuming everything's linear, let's say a dispersion, like what we showed you before, instead of having the little sweep in it, is straight, okay? So you measure this pulse, and it looks like this in the frequency time domain, and we'll give it, you know, and it's received here at antenna number one. All right, so it crosses the bandwidth B and a time T, and it has a gradient F dot, okay? That's the, people like maths, that's the thing for the maths. Okay, so then let's say that you have the same chirp, we call this a chirp time frequency thing. Let's say that you have the same thing, but it's received by another antenna some time delta T later, okay? So it's exactly the same thing, has the same gradient, okay? It's received some time delta T later. And so there's a constant difference in frequency here, right? Delta F. It's always the same across the whole chirp, as long as, you know, the other chirp has arrived. And so that has that sort of formula. If I take these two red lines, which are basically voltage stream, right? If I take one and I take the complex conjugate of the other, and I multiply them together, what's going to happen is that this chirp here down converts this chirp here, okay? So the constant frequency difference basically stays this, you know, results in a, again, on the same axes, you get nothing while they don't cross over. But while they do cross over, you get basically something with constant frequency for a fixed amount of time. Something with constant frequency for a fixed amount of time is just a tone. And so you can take the Fourier transform of that, and you'll get a spike, okay? So and the frequency of that spike is related to the delta T up here for a given dispersion measure, which is the gradient. Okay, I'll move on. The next step is that was just for one baseline. Okay, so the amount of delay will depend on the length of your baseline. So the larger the baseline, the more delay there'll be for a given angle of arrival. So it's very simple geometry here. You just have a baseline d, and you know the angle of arrival is theta, and the delta t is this kind of distance here. And so what you'll end up with is, if you have a bunch of baselines, this is the baseline here, and this is the frequency that you, the peak frequency after you take the DFT before you transform. So for the short baselines, you'll get a small frequency. As the baseline, as you get longer baselines, the frequency will increase. And it's just a linear relationship. And so then the imaging problem is you just add along these baselines for different trial positions on the sky, okay? So you can try along here and you don't see anything, and you try along here and you don't see anything, you don't try along here and you don't see anything, and you add up along here and, oh, hello, that's where my source is coming from. So you can look at the point spread functions, and I've simulated a few, and I got some data from the GMRT, and you know, they kind of match up. GMRT data was a bit difficult to use. The point with the Chirpolator was that's kind of nice is that these beams here is not the same size as a synthesized beam. It's actually what's the same size as what's called a delay beam, which is much bigger. So you need fewer beams to take out your whole primary beam, to look at your whole primary beam. You need fewer pixels than you would need for a synthesized image. It's not obvious, but true. Okay. The second technique is called the Chimageator. It's a bit more closely related to the standard interferometry. So in this case, what we do is we get the voltage from one antenna, and we grid it. We basically do gridding and Fourier transforming in the same way that you do for normal interferometry, except you don't multiply the antennas together first. You just take the voltages and you grid the voltages. Okay, so you put all the voltages together. If you've got long baselines, they live on the outside of the Fourier plane. If you've got short baselines, they live on the inside of the Fourier plane. You do a Fourier transform of that voltage data. And what you see as time goes on, this is time here or sample number here, is that you get a trajectory in this and what in the frequency bins. You get these trajectories, and then you can sum along the trajectories and get for different dispersions this time, and you can basically make an image in the same way. Now, what's interesting about these things is the computational cost. So I've broken the computational costs up here into, say, the hardware, which happens, you know, pre-integrator, and the software, which is sort of post-integrator. So if you have a look at the classical things here in the grey and black lines, you can see that this is a standard correlation type of thing. It's very cheap in terms of hardware. I mean, it's hard to build correlators, don't get me wrong, but in this kind of domain, it's actually quite cheap. And the Chirpolator and the Chimageator, you know, they're very expensive. And the beam flow, if you do tight array beams, you know, it gets to be good in terms of, if you have really lots of antennas, you start to win, but it doesn't really win very quickly. The interesting stuff is the Chirpolator here, post-integrator. So in terms of your software, if you've got 100 antennas, you need like 10 GPUs. It's ridiculous. It's really cheap, which is kind of nice. On the other hand, the Chimageator is awful. So 10 to the 17 flops or something, it's ridiculous. Anyway, post-integrator, the Chirpolator is very efficient, but it costs you a lot in hardware. The other thing that's interesting is the data rate between these two elements, right? So you're going to have hardware over here and software over here, and you need to shuffle data between these two things. The Chirpolator here is quite cheap. Until it gets to about 1,000 antennas or so. But it really saves you on data rate. And I would argue that going forward, flops are really floating up, you know, the operations, the actual floating point operations that you need to do are not really going to be the problem anymore. The problem is going to be shuffling the data around. So if you're looking to do algorithms, it's nice to make them computationally efficient, but I think it's going to become increasingly the case that your algorithms are data efficient. So these have the nice property that they're at least data efficient up to about 1,000 antennas. And then it's really hard to beat. The Fourier imaging really dies at that state for a large number of antennas in terms of data rate. So here are my conclusions. I've talked about the Molonglo survey, and we've gone and covered a few interesting sources, and got some new statistical techniques. I've talked about the GRB survey. It's proven a concept. We've got a few candidate pulses. We're following those up. I've talked about two new techniques, the Chirpolator and the Chimageator. There are plenty more algorithms out there that people are working on. For my ones, the computational cost might be higher, but the data rate might be lower, so that might actually make them favorable for future implementation. They may be preferable for small to medium arrays. I'll leave it there. Thank you.